apologize. This is Josephine Baker, which is what you cannot read because that's gotten cut off on the screen there. So we're moving a little bit closer, more recent in U.S. history. So I told you in the introduction that she is an incredibly successful, famous, and considered to be, like I said, the first really global superstar, an African-American woman superstar. So we'll talk about that. She's born in the United States, in Missouri, right at the beginning of the 20th century. And she is, this is her, when she's doing part of her vaudeville routine, which is how she basically gets her start in show business. We don't really have vaudeville anymore. That's not really a thing. So it kind of combines theater and dance and comedy routines and singing and, you know, all of that put together. So it's very expressive. There's a lot of silliness. And she became incredibly famous in her dance troupe in the U.S., by being, they kind of had like, there was the funny one. She was the comedian, right? So she would be at the end of the line of all of these dancers, and she would be, you know, the gag routine. So she became most famous starting out, like I said, in vaudeville, and at a very young age, right? So she began, if you can imagine beginning your career at the age of 13. She's married twice by the time she's 15. And so that's her name, Baker, is from her second husband. So she very quickly realizes that, you know, she doesn't necessarily want to stay in the United States, and she doesn't necessarily want to stay with her second husband. And she, part of the reason why she chooses to move to Europe and to France in particular is because there's a lot more opportunity for African-American performers there than there is in the United States at this time. Segregation has been institutionalized under Plessy v. Ferguson, Jim Crow laws, you might be familiar with those, really discriminatory race-based laws throughout much of the United States and particularly in the Southeast. So she, there's a lot of limitations on how much, where she can perform and how successful she can be. So she chooses to move to Europe where these kinds of restrictions are not in place. So she goes and performs in an all-black dance troupe, and I'm going to destroy the French every single time, so if you speak French, I apologize in advance, all right? So La Revue en Negre is as close as I can get to it in the French, and she does that at the early 1920s, so again, an all-black dance troupe. She participates and performs with them for a couple of years before she strikes out on her own. So incredibly, we're going to watch a little bit of her performing at the end, so you can kind of see her in action, because me describing it doesn't really do it justice. But she has a force of personality and a stage presence that is undeniable. And she becomes pretty much instantaneously famous in France as a result of this. So she ends up performing at the Folies Bergères, which is a pretty famous dance venue in Paris. And this picture that you've been staring at for a little while is of her in, basically it's the banana dance costume. And this is the thing that really propels her into fame, right? This is like her signature dance, at least in her younger years, that she becomes really well known for. So there's some problems with the banana dance, but people today still debate whether this is a potentially empowering sort of decision or whether this plays into existing stereotypes of the time period. And some people think that there's a combination of both there. So there's a lot of fascination with everything Africa at this time in Europe. You know, the colonial process has been underway for quite a long time in Europe as of the 1920s. So there's a lot of interest in this revival, particularly during the 20s of everything Africa. And this particular dance was performed in the context of she is an indigenous African woman, and basically there's these white hunters who come and this dance between them. People argue that she expresses a lot of agency in this particular performance, though, because she's the one in charge of the interactions with the white hunters. She leads them on this kind of merry dance, and at the end of it basically tells them with body language to what they can go do with themselves. For lack of a better word, and since I don't want to I don't want to cuss, but you guys can fill in the blanks there. So there's, people argue that there's a lot of agency to this particular dance, and that she, the other thing that you should keep in mind is that she didn't, no one gave her this costume. She was the one who designed it. Alright, so, you know, that's something to factor in there as well. So you all can make a decision on whether you think this is, you know, playing into existing stereotypes, or whether it's empowering, or it's a combination of those things. I will leave that to you. So, Josephine Baker is going to be propelled into fame, like I said, through her dancing. That's how she gets her start. But she's very quickly going to start a singing career as well. So her earlier singing is not considered to be the greatest, but as she gets older, her talent and her voice develop considerably. Because you have to remember, she was 13 when she started dancing. She's 19 when she goes to Paris. She's very young. And so she's going to really cultivate her style both in dancing and in singing as the years go on. She also starts acting, right? And what's really remarkable is that she is, like I said, the very first black actor, male or female, to star in an international motion picture. Right, the very first. And she will, Siren of the Tropics is the one that she gets her start in. So these are all silent films, the first ones that she is going to be showing in silent films. So if you didn't know, right, they didn't used to always be talking in movies. The very first films were silent, and they'd be accompanied by, you know, usually some kind of dramatic musical score and also fun subtitles at the bottom of the screen just in case you weren't sure what was happening. But very dramatic acting, and her background in vaudeville, right, which is very expressive and sort of what we would consider to be campy and kind of overblown currently, is translates very well in silent film. So she's able to really just skyrocket to fame at an international level because of her participation in these films. So another one that's pretty popular is called Princess Tam-Tam. Again, she's an African princess and in Europe, intermingling with all these fancy people. And the idea is that she's supposed to kind of assimilate into European culture and be this appropriate, ladylike sort of individual. And basically, she does away with all that. She tries for a while, and then in the kind of big culminating scene at the end, you know, she tears off half of her dress and goes down to dance in this fantastic number. The real big controversial thing that basically gets it banned in the United States at this time is because the prince, who is supposed to be her love interest, is not black. Right? So an interracial relationship, that's big time taboo. Right? That's illegal throughout the United States at this time, interracial relationships. And so that's why it's scandalous for the time period, at least in the United States, and that's why it's banned in the United States, because it depicts her on equal-ish footing, but in an interracial relationship. So she's a dancer, she's a singer, she's a film star, and of course, if you're going to be propelled into superstardom, you have to have, you know, sponsors. Right? So she ends up getting a lot of people hair products and all kinds of things, fashion. She becomes this fashion mogul. People want to wear their hair like her. Her hairstyle is called the Josephine. It's like this Marcel wave, becomes super popular, and all these white French ladies want her hair, you know, and it's really this amazing thing where she becomes this icon. That's why I'm saying using the word superstar as an accurate depiction, because she's basically blown it up in all of these different kinds of fields and is making a ton of money. She's the best paid woman in Europe at this time in terms of performers, and African-American woman for sure. So, she, now that she basically has had almost a decade of success in France, she moves, she doesn't move back to the United States, but she travels to the United States to try and basically be famous there as well. Problems though, we're still talking about the same kind of racism and segregation the reason she left the United States in the first place, is still very much in force during the 1930s. So that's going to be a problem for her. She's going to have some successes, but she's still going to be running into segregation. And she was very adamantly opposed to performing for segregated audiences. She said, I will not perform for segregated audiences. I refuse. So she takes a stand against racial discrimination and segregation really early on in her career, and it's part of the reason why she's not able to be as successful in the United States as she is in Paris. So she basically goes back to France after this kind of disheartening lack of success in the United States. She gets married to a Frenchman. She kind of absolves herself of her U.S. citizenship. She doesn't do away with it entirely, but she becomes a French national through her marriage here to her now third husband, if we're keeping track. And if you're paying attention to the dates, World War II is upon us. And very quickly during World War II, France becomes occupied and overrun by Germany as of 1940. So very early on, she is interested in participating in the war and working against the Germans. And she basically hooks up with some French resistance fighters to, you know, again, the French resistance is meant to try and take France back from the Germans. She works for them, but is kind of a spy, right? So she's not an overt sort of operative. She goes around traveling and doing her entertaining thing, and she's able to basically have French resistance operatives functioning as her band, as her stage crew, all that sort of stuff. And she's able to slip information about enemy movements and activities in her sheet music. So lots of kinds of covert assistance there in terms of helping the French resistance during World War II. And she's going to end up going to, it gets a little too hot for her in France, and she's super famous, so there's a lot of scrutiny. So she ends up going to North Africa, which is also under, parts of North Africa, Morocco in particular, are under the control of the Germans at this time. So she's performing there. And she starts performing as North Africa gets taken over by Allied troops. She starts performing for Allied troops in North Africa. And again, refuses to play to segregated groups of white and black troops. Insists that black troops have front row seating in these audiences that she's performing to. So she's continuing her work, again, helping the Allies as she can, and also really promoting this idea of being opposed to segregation in the ways that she's able to. So because of her activities during the war on behalf of France, she's awarded an honorary title in the Air Force, and she's awarded several medals by the French government. And you can see her here in her military uniform. So this is not the end of her career. This is like part two. She is able to take this these activities that she's done on behalf of France during the war and really help that propel her into even greater stardom than she had experienced before. Because she's now, in addition to being this fantastic performer, a French heroine. A French heroine. So it kind of marks a different sort of turn, though, in her career. She's a bit older now. She's not, you know, this kind of young dance hall sort of girl kind of vibe going on. She's now sort of like the grande dame. She's wearing these really beautiful ball gowns. And again, she still dances, but singing becomes even more important as her career goes on. And that's in time with her voice becoming more mature and developed and rich. So again, still refusing to basically perform in front of racially segregated crowds. Tries going back to the United States again. Right, you're going to see a pattern here, I hope. She goes back to the United States again, and she has more success than she had in the 1930s, but she's still going to run into several different problems. So she gets these bookings, and it seems like it's all going really well, but then she's discriminated against in a restaurant. And she's got a lot of friends, and some of them are journalists. One of those newspaper editors is there at the restaurant with her, and she thinks that he should have done something, right, to kind of intercede on her behalf, because basically she and her party are left there sitting at a table without service for hours before they finally get up and leave. And that's a very common thing at this time when we're talking about segregation of public buildings and facilities and restaurants and all of that. So she gets up and she basically kind of tells off this newspaper editor as she leaves, this creates a big to-do. He writes poorly about her in the papers, and most of these bookings that she's had now get canceled. Okay. So it's very disappointing for her because, again, she has these successes in France. She's recognized by the NAACP, right, as this woman of the year, and then all of these bookings end up going away because of this negative attention in the press. So she'll go back to France. She'll continue basically touring there and throughout Europe. And she'll go back to the United States again. She goes periodically back and forth. But she will return for the March on Washington. Excuse me, that's the really famous march with you know, 250,000 people. The one where Martin Luther King Jr. gives his I Have a Dream speech. She goes up there, and she's actually one of the people who presents the March on Washington in her French uniform, talking about basically her experiences and her opposition to segregation and some of the realities for African Americans during this time period. All right. So, again, these are some of my favorite pictures of her. So, incredibly famous. An advocate for the ending of racial discrimination, and again, she tries again and again through her abilities as a performer to really push for the things that she feels are necessary. Later in life, she will adopt 12 children from different parts of the world. She calls them her village, and the idea there is that she is trying to model the fact that segregation is unnecessary, that everybody can coexist and live together in harmony, and that her family is a literal representation of that. So she goes on to perform into her 70s, right? And she performs up to the day before she dies, she performs. Right? So she is incredibly committed to her ideas of social justice, to ending discrimination, and she's able to do so in a way, in a very public kind of way, and in a way that's true to her, all the while being incredibly famous, and like I said, one of the highest paid women performers in the world at this time. So, I have a couple, but because in the interest of time, I'm just going to see if this one will work. And you can see her in action, because again, it does not really do it justice for me to just talk about it. So this is in France, so she is singing in French at first, so in case you're wondering why you can't understand her, then.
Thank you.